this is the first Roger Bobo's Festival of Brass, 2015. And we thought that it would be really great that on the campus of Jones County Junior College, that we would have the opportunity as part of the master classes, part of the lessons, the chamber ensembles, everything that we did over the course of the past few days, if we could take an opportunity to interview Roger Bobo. And we have some interview questions that have already been prepared. And if there's time at the end, we'd like to hear from you. We could go back, touch base. If there's anything you wanted to elaborate on, or if there's anything that we didn't hit, you would have the opportunity then to ask questions and talk about his career, his life, and everything that he's willing to tell us, if that's all right with you.
Okay.
Well, let's begin. Many people describe you as a world-renowned teacher, a virtuoso soloist, a pioneer of the tuba, and the list just keeps going on and on. For our audience today, which is a younger generation, can you give us a brief synopsis or a timeline of your career from when you started until about now?
Yeah, briefly, I think I started when I was 7 years old on the trumpet, and I didn't like the practice. So interested, but it was fun. And when I was 11, I went from my elementary school to my junior high school and encountered a sousaphone up in the corner of that room. And within 15 seconds, I had come back in there and I had climbed into it and I was playing. And it worked. I could play right away. I could play all the tunes that I could play on the trumpet, which I specifically remember, and please don't laugh, there was the Syncopated Clock and Sweet Little Annie. And I played those, and people came around and watched me. It was sort of freaky because I never played a tune before. And instantly, I got attention, and I think that probably pushed me into the, I like this system. It gets attention. So I played through junior high school, played solos with my high school band quite soon. Then I went to the National Music Camp when I was 15, 16, 17, and 18 years old, and played in the National High School Orchestra at Interlochen, Michigan, which just immersed me into a society of people, the age of the people who were participating in this group. And I'm going to Interlochen next week. As a matter of fact, the first time in 59 years, I'm really excited about that. It probably, maybe, perhaps, might have changed. But I'm looking forward to that. And I got to play enormous amounts of symphonic repertoire. National High School Orchestra, the National High School Band, the ensembles. It was fantastic. While I was there, I met Frederick Fennell. And then you don't know, but he was the famous, most famous American band director at the time. And he was the one who developed the Eastman Wind Ensemble. And I played for him, and he invited me to come to Eastman. I went to Eastman. Just by chance, I've been blessed by chronic good luck. Just by chance, there was an opening in Rochester Philharmonic. And during freshman week, I auditioned and I got the job. So I was 18, I got the job in Rochester Philharmonic, which put me in a position to be in contact with great players and great conductors. And I went through Eastman in my first year, it would have been 1961. A friend of mine asked me if I'd like to play a recital in Carnegie Hall in New York City. Let me correct that because I don't want to get the wrong impression. Carnegie Recital Hall in New York City. And I did it. And lucky again, I got really great reviews, a lot of publicity. John Updike, the famous poet, one of the headlines, I think Roger Bobo plays the tuba, it was just some critique of the recital. And he saw Bobo and tuba, and he got a, you know, poet's computer readout of a poem. And I can remember it, but I'm not sure I'm going to start that. Barracuda off Aruba, Eskimos in Manitoba, cockaneer when Roger Bobo starts the solo on the tuba. Men of every station, nabob, hobo, toff, and bozo, cockaneer, indubitably, there is simply nobody that oopas on the tuba solo quite like Roger Bobo. I can't believe I just said that. I told you that. That's the essence of the Negro trip. But that, it put a spotlight on me that I'm not sure I deserve. I mean, everything just soared from then on. And I got my master's degree at Eastman, and I wrote letters to European orchestras because I was fascinated by what's going on outside of the United States. And I still am. And I wrote, I think it was 20 letters to all the orchestras I could find addresses of. And two of them had two orchestras. One was L'Orchestre de Suisse-Romande in Geneva, Switzerland. And the other one was the Concerto Orchestra of Amsterdam, Holland. I auditioned for both jobs, and I was offered both jobs, and I took the Concerto. I played there for 2 years, and then I moved to Los Angeles and played in the LA, Los Angeles Philharmonic. And I started doing a lot of solos, made some solo recordings that worked very well. Started then, even a long time ago, started with master classes. Wasn't very good at presenting a master class. I was absolutely disoriented. I didn't know what to do. And I played in LA for 25 years. And I decided to take a sabbatical. How much detail do you want?
Keep going. I'm enjoying myself.
And I couldn't figure out where to go on the sabbatical. It was a new program. Los Angeles Philharmonic had just started this program. I said, okay, I'm going to go to China. That's really different. I want something really different. And I thought that over, and I feared that the party atmosphere that I was used to in Los Angeles wasn't going to happen in Beijing. So I decided I would go to Kenya. And I had this sort of fantasy I was going to get a brass quintet, get the instruments for a brass quintet, take them into some indigenous tribe and pass them out and take notes on what happened without giving any guidance. That was sort of a naive intellectual idea. And my doctor said, don't go, you're going to get sick. And I said, okay. And in the meantime, Subin Mehta was pushing me to go to Italy. And I went to Firenze, I went to Florence. And I started playing frequently with the Maggio Musicale Orchestra, which is the Florence Opera and the Florence Philharmonic Orchestra. It's called the Maggio Musicale. And I played there quite a lot. Shall I keep going, the same story? Yeah, okay. About 4 months into this sabbatical, I said to myself, Roger, I said, you're not going to go back to L.A. You don't want to go back. I said, you're right. I don't want to go back. And so I wrote the little letter. I said, I'm not coming back. They sort of went into shock. They couldn't believe it. They never thought that anybody of the L.A. Philharmonic would just choose to stay there. But I did. Subsequently ended up with them revising the sabbatical contract, and there is another paragraph there, which I proudly very proudly accept the name of it, the Bobo Claus. And it says, you gotta come back. And then I very quickly ran out of money. And I had a car that I bought when I first got here. And I would run out of gas. I didn't have money to buy gas. I didn't have money to eat. Somehow I managed. And all of a sudden, I got an email from the Fiesole Scuola di Musica, which is a private music school in Fiesole, which is just on the hill, 7 kilometers up the hill from Firenze. I want to say Firenze, but it's Florence. Firenze sounds beautiful. It is beautiful. And I took that job, taught there, chamber music, brass instruments, and it gave me a little income. And then all of a sudden, I got a job at the Lausanne Conservatory of Music in Switzerland. And very quickly, I got a job at the Bern Conservatory in Switzerland. And then right after that, I got a job at the Rotterdam's Conservatorium in Rotterdam. And actually moved and lived in Amsterdam while I worked at Rotterdam. And then I also became nearly full-time at the Royal Northern College of Music in Manchester, England. So I had all 5 of those jobs full-time. I lived on airplanes and trains. I worried about the well-being of my daughter. People were helping me take care of her. We lived there alone in Florence. And it was a fascinating time, and I just couldn't maintain all 5 of those jobs at once. And when my daughter graduated from high school, she went to study at the University of Wales for her bachelor's degree, and I moved to Lausanne, Switzerland. I lived there. And while I was in Lausanne, I think I was there at least 10 years, more, 13. And I was invited to go do master classes in Japan. And I took the job. And I went to another conservatory, Hiroshima. I taught in Hiroshima for 2 years. And then I moved to Tokyo and taught at the Musashino Ongaku Daigaku, Musashino Academy of Music. And I stayed there for 8 years. So all in all, I was in Japan for about 10 years. And it was time to leave Japan. I loved Japan. I still love Japan. I'm going back to Japan over the holidays. I was there last year for the holidays. Christmas Day last year, I gave a master class in a school in Tokyo. Osaka. And when I left Japan, I didn't know what I was going to do. And circumstances took me to a festival in Mexico called Instrumento Oaxaca. And there I met a young brass quintet from an indigenous music school up in the mountains, about 400 kilometers up in the mountains. And I ended up getting a job there, and I worked up there with these indigenous people, which was fascinating. And the talent there was absolutely amazing. And the naivety was also amazing. They had never heard of Bach. They had never heard of Tchaikovsky. They had never heard of the song Summertime. They had never heard of the movie Star Wars, because I was playing a piece from the music of Star Wars. All they knew was this Mexican music, which they played great. It's wonderful. But to teach them how Bach, how to play a chorale, and what legato was a task. So they had this mariachi conception of music. the chorale went, then pick up the trumpets. Dum, 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 dum. That took me 7 weeks to get the style right with them. And then we did it. We played a concert in the marketplace in this village called Tlahuitoltepec. And it was a big success. So then I went back to Southern California, which was my home, my birthplace. And then I was missing Mexico a lot. And I went back down and started organizing that maybe I could get a job there. To make a long story short, I presented it up. I proposed that we organize a brass ensemble there. And the cultural department of the city of Oaxaca and the Oaxacan Conservatory accepted that. And so I moved there. I now live in Oaxaca. I have a house outside of Oaxaca, just on the edge of Oaxaca. It's paradise. I love this place. I'm sure I'm going to stay there many, many years. And I do these kind of things, master classes all over the world. Just 1 month ago, I was on a 70-day trip, crisscrossing the Atlantic between Europe and the East Coast. Finally came to the West Coast. I played many, many places. And other than the fact that I had, in those 70 days, 19 different flights that I had to catch, 19 different security checks that I had to pass through, which made me all the more want to go to Oaxaca and live. It's a calm place, very gentle people, actually. And I do a lot of master classes, as I'm doing now, all over the States. But now, as I told the class this afternoon, this one is special. I have never encountered, first of all, people are fast. Now, part of it, I have to say, is that you all speak English. And I don't have to get it translated from Mije to Spanish to English. I can just do it in English and it's understood. So that saves a lot of time. That makes it easy. But there's more to it than just that you guys all speak English. There's something special. There's sort of a collective bonding that's been taking place. And I'm very, very comfortable here. I haven't experienced this before. And now this is the last day, and I'm a little bit sad. I remember when I was a boy, I used to go to Nantucket and then I'd go home, and I was so camp sick for a couple of weeks or a month. I almost died, you know. God, I want to go back to Nantucket. I feel like I'm going to be the same way starting tomorrow when I go back to Nantucket.